Okay, let's start the racing. Okay, as I promised you before of the break, I will show you how to calculate the entanglement entropy in conformal field theory by using this formula here. Okay? So, we are considering the entanglement entropy of one interval, A, between two points U and V, and the distance between U and V is equal to L. As we already discussed at long, calculating trace of rho A to the n in this geometry is the same as the partition function on an n-sheeted Riemann surface with branch cut on the interval UV. And you remember it was this geometry here, okay? Where all these objects were joined in this cyclical way, okay? We should remember what it means. It was already suggested by some of you, I don't remember who, maybe was sitting here, but I don't remember the face now, that you can use conformal transformation to make this geometry nicer, okay? But making a conformal transformation, we just have seen, that gives rise to an easy operation within conformal field theory, like for the stress energy tensor here and for the two-point function. In general, for an arbitrary field theory, making a conformal transformation will not be a very useful operation. But so what we should find a conformal transformation that takes this surface, let's call it Rn, and map it to some geometry of which, for example, we know the result, right? For example, the complex plane. And then using the conformal mapping, like this formula here, to get the results in our geometry, okay? So what is the transformation that map this surface into the complex plane? Okay, let's just focus on one of the sheets, okay? So this is our Z-plane, okay? It's one of the sheets of the Riemann surface. Then imagine there are many. Okay, the first transformation that you can make was suggested yesterday is to take this branch cut here and map where usually you have in making the roots, which means on the real negative axis, no? Okay, so you take this Z plane and you map to some zeta plane, okay, where now this branch cut here, we have colors, this helps. This brown branch cut here, now it's here. Do you know the transformation that makes this game? Okay, you want to map like U to zero and V to infinity, so the transformation that makes this game is zeta equal Z. Actually, in my note, I call this guy W, so let's use the same notation, else I will mess up. Z equal W minus U divided W minus V. And you see that with this transformation, when W is equal to zero, this when w is equal to u, z is equal to 0, okay? While when w is equal to v, zeta is equal to minus infinity. So infinity, that's okay. Infinity is all a single point, so wherever it is, it's the same thing. Okay, so this transformation maps the interval uv in 0 minus infinity in each sheet of the Riemann surface, okay? It means now that this is one of the sheets, but there are n of them, okay? And in this geometry, it means that when I'm turning around this branch point, okay, after I make one turn around the branch point, I'm not on the same sheet on the Riemann surface, but I'm on the sheet above, for example, okay? Then I turn at that time, and I'm on the sheet above. How many times I should turn around the branch point to get back to the original plane? N times, okay? So you can see that, very trivially, the operation that map this n-sheeted surface in just in a stupid plane with nothing is the power of order 1 over n. Okay? By making this operation, each of the sheet of Riemann surface is a corner of opening angle, for example, 2 pi over n. Like this is the for n equals 6. You can imagine it's something like that, okay? So each sheet of Riemann surface is a corner of opening angle 2 pi over n. You see it, no? What is happening? This is basic conformal transformation, but better to. So overall, the transformation that map our n-sheeted Riemann surface to the complex plane, I plug this formula here, is w minus u divided w minus v, everything to the power 1 over n. Okay, what I do with this formula? Okay. I follow Belavin Polyakov and Samolodchikov, and I calculate this guy. I want to calculate, according to this formula, that so I don't erase, because it's already written. I want to calculate the stress energy tensor on the Riemann surface, okay, knowing the stress energy tensor on the plane. And actually, I will calculate the expectation value of the stress energy tensor. T of W on the stress energy tensor, knowing the expectation value of the stress energy tensor on the plane. What is the expectation value of the stress energy tensor on the plane? 0. Why? Yeah, okay, that's the main. It's flat means that it must be independent on z. Okay, it's translational invariance and rotational invariance. It should be, its integral should be the energy density. It must be finite. The only number that integrated gives a finite number is 0. Okay, so it's 0. So expectation value p of z in the complex plane is 0. So the only thing that matters is the Schwarzian derivative. I leave you as an exercise to make the first, the second, and the third derivative as written here. Actually, don't make any of the exercise. Just ask Mathematica to make the three derivatives. Okay? And you get here that the anomalous term gives C over 24. 1 minus 1 minus n squared w minus u squared. Okay, this is what you get. Sure. Sorry, especially soon after the light, I understand that this is very difficult to read. And if you remember when we defined the twist field, this formula here, the expectation value of any operator on the n-sheeted Riemann surface, can be taught as the expectation value of twist field, so of multiplied by the operator, okay, with the multiple Lagrangian on the complex plane, Lagrangian of n fields, okay, divided by tau n, okay, this is just the normalization, okay. This was the definition of twist field, okay, that the insertion of the twist field in a correlation function gives the expectation function, the expectation value of whatever is remaining on the n-sheeted Riemann surface. There is one thing that we should mention. Here we inserted the stress energy tensor only in one point, but there are n sheets, okay? So if we want to relate to the total energy density of the theory, the one with the ln here, better to compute. You remember that the Lagrangian was the sum of the Lagrangian, and the Hamiltonian was sum of the Hamiltonian. This is, we said, I explained this on Tuesday, okay? You may remember that this Ln that appeared here was the sum from I to n of the Lagrangian of the single theory, just each for each field of the sheets, no? You remember the story, and we said also then the total Hamiltonian should be the sum of the single Hamiltonian, no? Since the stress energy tensor is just the density of the energy, the total energy tensor, the total, which means where I insert one stress energy tensor on each sheet, is just the sum of n of this guy. So T total, introduced symmetrically in W, in Rn is just n times this guy. So C over 24, n minus 1 over n, the same formula as before. Okay, now, if you know conformal field theory, by looking at this formula, it would come immediately to your mind, even without thinking, okay, the so-called conformal world identity, okay? How many of you knows what is conformal world identity? Very few, probably. Okay, zero, wow. The conformal world identity is just the world identity for conformal field theory, that is the way you construct conformal field theory, and I can write you the formula and you see why it should come to your mind, okay? That if you have a primary field, the expectation value of the stress energy tensor on the two-point function Z1, Z2, okay, so the ratio between the two-point function with the insertion of the primary field and the two-point function itself is just given by the scaling dimension of the field times Z1 minus Z2 squared divided Z minus Z1 squared, Z minus Z2 square. Okay? So this is the conformal world identity that tells you, okay, what happened to a primary field when you make a conformal transformation, okay? Because the stress energy tensor makes locally a conformal transformation. If you compare these two formula, if you actually, not if you compare, if you look at these two formula, imagine that you knew this, and now you calculate and you get this. The formula is exactly the same. Okay, there is no difference, just written in different letters, but it's exactly the same formula. So this correspondence tells us that, okay, let's write it. Okay, this equivalence tells us that under conformal transformation, twist fields are like, I don't want to say equivalent, they are equivalent if you want, like primary field with scaling dimension delta n equals c over 24 n minus 1 over n. You understand the logic, no? The insertion of a stress energy tensor on a two-point function tells you what happened to the two-point function when you make an infinitesimal, a local conformal transformation, okay? If the expectation, this expectation value is identical to that of the primary field, then under an infinitesimal conformal transformation, they transform the same, and then you can integrate this transformation as I didn't show you, but as you should, as you know how to get that for any transformation, you get exactly the same thing. If infinitesimal is the same story, it's not a big, cannot be different globally, okay? So, this twist field that we introduced to characterize the branch points, okay? Are under conformal transformation, so they are in conformal field theory, primary operators. If they are primary field or primary operator, their two-point function, tau n u, tau tilde n v, that's what we want to calculate, will just be equal, proportional, to u minus v times minus 4 delta n, okay? The 4 instead of the 2 is just because in this conformal identity, the delta is half of the x that I was mentioning in the previous hour, okay? The delta that appears in this formula is half of x that I wrote before, if you want in this. The delta that appears here, it's x that I wrote before divided by 2. That's why there is 4 here. But this two-point function was exactly trace of rho a to the n we were searching for. So we have that raise of rho a to the n is equal to some constant cn, that is the proportionality constant here that we don't know, but doesn't matter too much, L to the minus c divided by 6 and minus 1 over n. This is the final result for the moments of the reduced density matrix within a conformal field theory. Okay? The constant Cn here means that it's independent on L. So the scaling in L is all this one, and then there is some constant that is not specified by the calculation. Okay, now we calculated this for integer n. What is the analytic continuation to non-integer n? Hey? One that talk? Yes, exactly. You just promote n to be non-integer, okay? The same formula, just n doesn't matter if it's integer or not. It's not sometimes the analytic form, the formula for integer n just enter explicitly the fact that n is integer, like if you get a sum over something, okay, up to n, then you should analytic continue in some way. But in this case, it's just trivial. The analytic continuation is the function itself, just that you promote n to be a non-integer number. Okay? So the entanglement entropy will be minus the derivative with respect to n of trace of rho a to the n. Okay, let's make the calculation. It's very simple, but let's do over the other side. Trace of rho a to the n is equal to cn. We have to take the derivative with respect to n, so better to write this object as cn e to the minus c over 6 n minus 1 over n log l, okay? So that taking the derivative is easy. Just okay. By the way, the Cn is unknown, but C1 is equal to 1, okay? So we have 1, because C1 is 1. E to the minus C over 6. Okay, but notice that this object for n equal 1 is 1. Okay, let's write everything. Cn, E to the minus C over 6, n minus 1 over n log L, times log L. Times the derivative of this guy, that is C over 6. 1 plus 1 over n squared, correct, times minus sign somewhere, no, minus sign just erase, and this is the final thing. Okay, plus derivative of cn for the function e to the minus, blah, 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 blah. But e to the, now we should calculate this object for n equal to 1. For n equal to 1, Cn is equal to 1, the exponential is equal to 1. So we have C over 3 log L plus the derivative of this Cn calculated in 1 that I denote as C1 prime So the final result is that for large L, the entanglement entropy behaves like C over 3 log L. And this is a result that I anticipated in the very first lecture. Okay, plus okay, a constant, but for large L, the constant is smaller than the logarithm. Yes? Before some trivial question, please, 2 plus 1 dimensional is just another. C1 is 1 by, that's what I said. C1 is 1 because trace of rho is 1. Okay? Please, this kind of question first, then we do generalization that, okay. UV cutoff is hidden, actually, when I said, good question. Where I wrote here, the two-point function should not, is not just, is proportional, and actually, you should, if you want this CN to be dimensionless, you put, like, a UV cutoff here. All lengths are measured in terms of UV cutoff, and you go over blah, 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 blah. But you can even alternatively say that UV cutoff is absorbing this non-universal constant, and who cares? OK, so if you want, but because in the end, the final formula, you can write like this, where if you write in this way, this C1 prime is dimensionless number. If instead you don't put A, this one is dimensional, but again, doesn't matter too much. Choose the one of the two that you prefer. It's completely equivalent, obviously, but very good question. Obviously, the UV cutoff gives a scale to the length, because length, the distances are not measured in neither in meter, neither in Fermi, okay, in a field theory. There is a scale, and the scale is given by UV cutoff. Very good question. More of this kind of question? Yeah, yeah, three comes from the fact that there is 12, et cetera, et cetera. Yes?
C divided by 12, and 12 is a sum
of. This is a long story, okay? For. What? I had here something. Twelve comes from the fact. Yes, now I remember. It's complicated, but you ask. Okay, the dimension of the twist field of the stress energy tensor is 2. So the two-point function of the stress energy tensor goes like distance of the 2-point to the power 4. To get to that formula, you should integrate this two-point function. So you get a 4 and a 3. And the product of 4 and 3 gives 12. But OK, it's so it's a consequence. It's a consequence of the fact that the scale, the physics is a consequence of the scaling dimension of the stress energy tensor is 2. That's where it comes from. Okay, then it's algebra. But if the dimension of the stress energy tensor would not have been 2, but another one, you would have got another number. But the physics is that. Okay, then from that 2 to get to that 12 is algebra. There is no physics. If you follow the derivation of this formula, the only ingredient that matters is that 4. The 2 that then becomes 4. If that would have been different here, you would have get a completely different number.
Analytical continuation by chalk, right? That you did?
Mm-hmm. if you start taking more complicated geometry, like instead of one interval T, this is a different topology, then the formula that you get is a complete different mess. And okay, actually, we have a formula for any n. You can check the literature, and no one is able to make the continuation. So the formula is so much complicated that okay, this operation, it was trivial and innocuous here. In the other case, become impossible. Okay. I hope one of you will solve the problem. It's an open problem. So if you are young, fresh energy, you can do it. Okay. The central charge, it has too many physical interpretations. Okay, now it depends on from which side you are looking at. Okay, I'm telling you some, then now you will see if you like. Usually say that the central charge counts the number of degrees of freedom of your theory, okay? Like central charge C equal to 1 corresponds to 1 boson, okay? And in terms of boson, 1 free boson, okay, like a Schrödinger liquid. And in terms of how many of that you have a theory, okay? But this can be even, it's not integer, okay? So not it must be only 2, 3, 4, 5. If you have 5 boson, central charge is 5. But like if you have an Ising model, the central charge is 1/2. But in fact, if you think properly, you can bosonize your Ising model, realize that it's a Majorana fermion, that is half of a Dirac fermion, and the Dirac fermion is equivalent to a free boson. So everything fits. Okay, this is the easy way, probably the most physical way of thinking the central charge. From the point of view of field theory, this formula shows you that it's an anomaly. Okay, if you had a classical field theory, you will have just this relation. But when you quantize the theory, the fact that there are commutators, that there are non-zero, generate this strange guy. And this is what in field theory is called an anomaly. Okay, something that is generated by the quantization. Okay? For a field theory, this is completely physical. I imagine that for a condensed matter, physics is not really some physical thing. But okay, and if we have time, and I think we have, you will see how this counting will enter in a very nice formula. Mm-hmm. No, it's C1. I'm taking the derivative. Okay, C1 is equal to 1. C1 is equal to 1 because trace of rho is equal to 1, okay? Let me write down. The derivative of C in 1 is not 0, and it's up here. There is something called Carson theorem that dates back to 1913 that tells you that if you know a function on all integer, plus you give some condition at infinity, you have a unique analytic continuation. Okay? And the condition at infinity doesn't come from the math, but comes from the physics. Basically, we are requiring, without telling, that the function has not essential singularity at infinity. You can imagine, what could make, let's give an example. If I have a function defined only on the integer, if to this function I add sine pi n multiplied by whatever function of n, on the integer, this function will get exactly the same number, okay? Because sine pi n is 0. But outside of the integer is different, and will give it a different derivative in 1. But what this guy introduces an essential singularity at infinity. Okay, so basically we are asking by the physics that there is no essential singularity at infinity. So all the non-uniqueness that you have in any continuation can be mapped not only in this, but in many variations of this, but always get to essential singularity. But that was a very good question. And actually, sometimes can happen that you write a formula that is not so easy, You have a bunch of gamma functions, you don't understand anything. You take the analytic continuation without thinking and you get the wrong answer because that bunch of gamma functions that you wrote, if you make the expansion close to infinity, you get an essential singularity. In that case, you should be very careful to check the singularity at infinity, subtract it, and get the right guy. But okay, this is for more complicated objects. More question? Here, there is no reference to the unitary. The point is, what is the entanglement entropy for a non-unitary CFT? That's, okay. What is the... This tells you that the entanglement entropy of the vacuum of a non-unitary CFT is that guy. But as you may know, if you know non-unitary CFT, the vacuum of a non-unitary CFT is not the ground state of the unitary CFT. So, okay. That's the trick, and more question before going to the 2 plus 1 dimension? Okay, so what you want to know about 2 plus 1? What you want to know about the 2 plus 1 dimension? Absolutely not. Even the first part, I don't know how to make the transformation. I made that transform. I used a conformal transformation to uniformize the Enchidon Riemann surface to a plane. In higher dimension, there is no such thing as a conformal transformation. There is nothing.
So what do you expect?
Hmm? As I anticipated, but completely different reasoning. In higher dimension, the scale invariant theory in higher dimension, sometimes you have area law, sometimes you have area law plus logarithmic violation. It's still not clear if there is a complete rationale for this. Okay? And okay, but that's what you expect. Either area law or area law with logarithmic, area law times log. Which is the same as in 1D, you have always times log, you see, log L. In higher dimensions, sometimes you don't have this log appearing. And okay, if there is a reason why sometimes it's like that or like the other, still unclear. It's a. In higher dimensions, there is not one way to get all the answers, like in 1D. You have to make a case by case calculation, and there are several calculations, and no one knows yet. What is universal and what is specific. More questions? Okay, if not, let me make the last small calculation. Okay, I want to use the fact that the twist field behaves like primary fields to use this formula for its stupid function. Okay, you remember, this is a formula that's still here since before the break. Okay, the two-point function of a primary field under a general conformal transformation, okay, transform in this way, with the derivative of the transformation acting as local scale factors. Okay? I want to use now this formula to relate the results that we got on the plane to the results that we got in other geometries. Okay? And the first geometry that I want to consider is the finite temperature. Okay? In the case of finite temperature, we have a cylinder of circumference beta. We have the two point U and V, where there are this twist field inserted, or if you want, these are Enchidon Riemann surfaces. But we can just think as trays of rho A to the N as the two point function of this twist field on the cylinder. Okay? So we can forget that there is this n-sheeted torus, okay? just we had to calculate the two-point function of primary object on the cylinder. But to do this, we should just map the cylinder to the plane. Okay, in my here I use the letter, which letter? Z for the coordinate on the cylinder, and W for the circumference on the plane. What is the transformation that map the cylinder to the plane? It's just W equal e to the pi 2 pi z divided by beta. You see that when z is an integer multiple of beta, you just get the same value, okay? This function is periodic, exactly like the cylinder, and it's the minimum of periodicity, so this is the function that mapped one into the other. Okay? You see that this function mapped the cylinder to the plane, no? Or, as opposite, the logarithm mapped the plane to the cylinder because it introduced a logarithmic branch cut that makes periodic the story. Now, the only thing we need to calculate this object is to calculate the derivative of the exponential, which, okay, not so difficult. It's just the exponential itself times 2 pi over beta. Okay, so let's use the formula and get raise of rho a to the n on the cylinder will be just the derivative in the two points, e to the 2 pi u divided by beta, e to the 2 pi v divided by beta, u pi over beta square. Okay, these are the two derivatives. The power c over 12 n minus 1 over n. Okay, time the two-point function on the plane, which we wrote as okay, so I just rewrote that formula. The two derivatives I wrote explicitly, okay, and I rewrote the two-point function in terms of the variable on the cylinder, okay? Now there is something funny that I want to let you notice. When you make this conformal transformation and you write as the derivative, in the intermediate passage, you lost the symmetry of this geometry. Okay, like this object is translational invariant. So the final result should be just a function of u minus v, not of u and v separately. But the derivative in u and the derivative in v are function of u and v separately. Yeah. So in this intermediate step, you lose this symmetry, in this case, translational symmetry, in other case, other symmetries. But the final results must be, and in fact, it's trivial. You just put this guy in, and let's see what happens. By putting this guy inside the power, you get again, the cn beta over 2 pi e to the 2 pi u minus v divided by beta minus e to the 2 pi v minus u divided by beta. Okay, yes, let's put parentheses. To the power minus c over 6 n minus 1 over n. And this is explicitly a function of u minus v. By the way, that object there is just the hyperbolic sign, so this is u goes in the hyperbolic sign. Sorry, the 2 here goes away, yeah? You see, when you put this guy inside, this is C over 12, This was C over 6. So you subtract one of the two pi's and you get only one. Sorry, I messed up. And then you don't get the two, and you don't get the two here. Okay, check the algebra. It's not really. The result is correct. Also, the step in the middle are correct. Just don't bother to understand them immediately now. But then the entanglement entropy, this guy is exactly of this form, just that instead of having L, you have the other function. So the entanglement entropy also is very simple. And we are almost done. Entanglement entropy is very simple. It's just C over 3 log of sinh pi L. Let's write it properly, as you don't read. It's a nice formula. Okay? So this is the final formula for the entanglement entropy at finite temperature in a CFT. Very simple formula. With this formula, I can take two limits. Okay, first of all, it's just a function of L divided by beta, as you see, no? So that's the main thing that matters. The scale is out, but doesn't matter too much. So if the temperature is low, which means beta is high, or if you want for L much smaller than beta, you can expand the hyperbolic sign, okay? And you just get the first order pi L over beta. Pi and beta cancel, and so for L much smaller than beta, you get back the C over 3 log L plus C1 prime that we just calculated, and okay, the function is correct. But for higher temperature instead, what we get? Or if you want for very large subsystem size, independent of the temperature, okay? You get an hyperbolic sign for very large argument is like an exponential. Correct? Here there is an exponential. The logarithm of the exponential is the argument itself. So the entanglement entropy is just C over 3 pi L over beta. If you want, you can write like C over 3 pi L T, where T is the temperature. Okay? What it is, this formula? It's surely a volume law, correct? So it extends, it's very high temperature, so the entropy is the entropy. The entanglement effect just went away. There is a volume law. What else? So L, we understand. This linearity in T, what tell us? Yeah, the volume law means extensive is synonymous. If you want, yes. So it is the thermodynamic entropy. Yes, this we already said. What is the thermodynamic entropy of a conformal field theory? Okay, let's put like that. Which thermodynamic entropy of a massless particle have you calculated in your life? I heard the right one, the first one. Who said photonic gas? Who told it? And so what is the thermodynamic, the black body radiation, how it goes for large temperature? Like T to the? To the? Depends on the dimension, people. okay? It goes like T to the D, space dimension. This is the one-dimensional Stefan Boltzmann law. This is 1D, Stefan Boltzmann. If the integral that you make for the black body radiation, you make it in 1D instead of making it in 3D, you get this formula for the entropy. T to the 4 is the energy, then you have to make one derivative to get the entropy. But someone was asking, what about this C? You remember that in the Stefan Boltzmann law, this is how many polarization has the photon, no? So how many of this particle you have? What is the generation? You see, here, in this formula, so in high temperature where it's all thermodynamic, et cetera, the central charge is counting you how many degrees of freedom you have. Okay, and by the way, if you make the calculation of Stefan Boltzmann law in 1D, even the pi and the 3 are all there. Eh? It's just that guy. There is a degeneration tube because of the polarization of the photon, but that's all the small factor are the right one. Okay, so this is what it is. Okay, at this point, I will just leave the left 5 minutes for question without stressing you with other small calculation. Just ask whatever you want. You're confusing me? Okay. This is the Feynman entropy of the reduced density matrix of a thermal ensemble. Okay? Since the entropy, okay, in this regime here, okay, in this regime here of very high temperature, in this regime, since the entropy is extensive, okay, taking a and L is large in this formula, okay? Taking a large system or taking an even larger, right, you will get always the same. This is extensivity. So it doesn't matter if it's the entire system or it's a subsystem, but only in this regime here, okay? When in fact the entanglement entropy, let's put like that, the entropy of the reduced density matrix is not a good measure of entanglement anymore, okay? Here you are just measuring the entropy. In this case. In fact, we said at the very first lecture that the entanglement entropy is a good measure of entanglement for pure state. So we are now calculating the entropy of the reduced density matrix, which is a nice object, but it's not a measure of entanglement anymore. At t equal to zero, or if you want in the limit of L much smaller than beta, you get a measure of entanglement. At different temperature, you get a number, which has nice thermodynamic interpretation, but it's not a measure of entanglement. Hmm? The entropy. What you have been calculating for a life before mentioning entanglement. Don't forget, entanglement entropy is anyhow an entropy. So it's always an entropy, okay? So, and with all the nice property of the entropy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It measures the entanglement in the case of a pure system, a bipartite pure system. But it remains a von Neumann entropy of a density matrix, anyhow. Yes. In the ideas, yes, it's exactly that. Okay, this, you need to know at the SFT, and I don't think anyone, many people know, but yes. You need a black body, a black hole in the center of your RDS to get a finite temperature. That was the next calculation that I would have done, but I didn't do. Okay, in that case, the cylinder, you have to make the map to a cylinder that is in this direction, where now here is space, x, and here is imaginary time, and it's infinite. And you take an interval here, okay, u and v. This corresponds to the same guy as before, just by sending beta in I, L, where L is the this circumference, and if you just make the substitution, you get SA C over 3 log of L divided by pi sine, not sine, sinch, pi small L divided by big L, okay? And you see very nicely this formula is periodic in L. It is symmetric in L that goes in L, capital L minus small L, which means A that goes to B, should be symmetric. And there's all the nice property. And this is a very important formula because, okay, in your computer you always have finite system and that's what you will use. This would be another lecture, it's not a question. If I would have had 4 hours, probably I would have taught that, but okay, it's not something just to, you have to understand what is a quench in CFT, what is initial state, it's complicated. Oh, this is another fine size, and fine temperature corresponds to a torus. Okay, and in this case, the torus has topologies that are different from a plane. So it's more complicated to make the calculation and does not depend only on C, depends also on other detail of the theory. And for some theory, it has been done. For others, okay, in principle, you know how to do, but it's extremely complicated. Okay, the calculation on the torus of the entanglement entropy exists, and okay, some are much more difficult, okay? You don't... With a conformal mapping, you can map only geometry with the same topology. Okay? You know, there is this Cauchy theorem that says that a topology of one dimension, the genus is invariant under conformal mapping. Okay, the torus has a null and it's not mappable to the plane, and so you have to make calculations that are not obtainable in this easy way. No, it's not a measure of entanglement, so it cannot be linked to any quantum thing. It's linked to the entropy of a classical system. That's... What do you mean? Don't mix up. I'm using now CFTs to study one-dimensional system at quantum critical point or quantum critical phases, okay? Not a classical two-dimensional system at finite temperature, which, okay. Things should be adapted, but it's the same story. But don't mix up the two things. They are related, but not the same thing. Yes, sure. Yeah. That you should use massive field theory. Yeah. The formula is C over 6 logarithm psi, okay, if you want divided by A. And okay, it's another calculation for a massive field theory. We did it 14 years ago. Now could have been another calculation that I would have done with more time, but okay, not. But you can understand that this formula is valid in the regime where the correlation length is much smaller than subsystem size, no? Sorry, much larger than subsystem size. When you don't see any more. So when you have a. What happened? For the entanglement entropy of a system that has a finite correlation length. If it's infinite, it just grows logarithmic as we plot. And then when you have a finite correlation length, it just saturates. And this saturation value is proportional to log psi divided by a, okay? And how to do it, okay, the calculation, it will require at least half an hour. No, this, it's in a conformal field theory, we show that for any conformal field theory, just what was written here, the transformation to this field tells you that it's a primary, full stop. For a one-dimensional, one plus one-dimensional conformal field theory, we have shown that it's a primary. In unitary, non-unitary, we didn't use anything of this theory. We just checked how it transformed like a primary, full stop. What do you mean? Mm-hmm. Because a photon is a CFT. A massless particle. It's a massless boson. You must recover. Not electron, but just the photons are a CFT. It's a in any dimension, eh? Okay, not in 1D. It's you can do, but even in 4D, it's a conformal electrodynamics without the f mu nu. That one is a CFT. Full stop. If you add the electron with the mass, then it's not anymore a CFT. But clear? That's that formula C over 3, the log psi. Before you follow the same, but then at some point you cross over to this other regime. Breaking the symmetry means giving a small correlation length to the system, no? And that's what happened. Okay, it seems there is no more question. Thank you for your attention.